with your own kind of power and your flesh and your bone, and notice what's happening inside you and around you. And also notice the land where you are right now, where you're sitting or standing or lying. We all, no matter where we are on in places made possible through stolen land and stolen labor. In this Philadelphia region, we are on land traditionally stewarded by the Lenni Lenape. Wherever you are, I invite you to connect with that sacred land and the lives that have gone before you in those places. May our worship and the work that we do, our relationships with one another and the world, honor our Indigenous siblings and the sacred lands on which we move and live and have our being. Amen. At this time, we are going to cast our vision back just a little bit to Christmas Eve, and we're going to see a video and hear a recorded song done by the singing group on Christmas Eve, this past Christmas Eve, and it's a song entitled "Would You Harbor Me?"
Good morning. I'm Kip, and my pronouns are he, him. I'm an associate pastor here, inviting you to join me in singing our opening song, which is from the 19th century, very prolific hymn writer, Fanny Crosby. Pass me not, O gentle Savior. We'll even get a little bit of that 19th century language in here with the these and thys and arts. And I invite you to to join me in singing wherever you are. Pass me not, O gentle Savior, this plea for the divine presence in our lives. Pass me not, O gentle Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. Let me at thy throne of mercy find a sweet relief. Kneeling there in deep contrition, help my unbelief. Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. Trusting only in thy merit, would I seek thy face. Heal my wounded, broken spirit, save me by thy grace. Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. Thou the spring of all my comfort, more than life to me. Whom have I on earth beside thee? Whom in heaven but thee? Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by.
Thanks, Kip. At this time, I would invite Michelle and Palmer Williams to lead us in the opening sentences and invite you to join in from wherever you are this morning.
People are aware that they cannot continue in the same old way,
but are mobilized because they cannot imagine an alternative.
We need a vision that recognizes that we are at one of the great turning points in human history.
When the survival of our planet and the restoration of humanity requires a great sea change.
In our ecological values,
in our economic values,
in our political values,
in our spiritual values.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Palmer. Thank you, Michelle, for all the ways that you lead us and for leading us in that way this morning. At this time, I invite our coordinator for children and youth, Ovid, to take it away.
Good morning, everyone. I am Ovid. My pronouns, which are words that you can use to call me when you don't call my name, my pronouns are they, them, their, and I also use the word love as a pronoun. Today, I would like to talk about trying new things. Priscilla is going to be telling us, I believe, a little bit about a situation in the Bible that involved trying new food. I know that can be difficult for a lot of us. I want us to think about eating and feeding because that's important. And I also wanted to share something about myself and give a little bit of a homework assignment. So, or what did I call it? A heart work assignment, love work. In the past 2 weeks, I've been to a couple of doctors, and I have learned that my hand slash wrist slash arm is not in the condition it was when I was born. It's not what I was used to. And so a couple of things are going on with my hand slash wrist slash arm. And this wonderful person fashioned me this brand new gauntlet. And that was very cool. It's shaped especially for my hand slash wrist slash arm. And on Friday, I went to visit someone called an occupational therapist. And that is a person who can help you figure out how to use your body in ways that will not make you hurt so much. So a couple of the things that she showed me were that I can use insulation, sort of spongy tubes, and I can put things like pencils in them so that I can have a better grip when I'm writing. She's shown me I can wrap up my paintbrushes, and that will also give me a better grip because I also drop things a lot. She gave me this thing that it looks like fruit roll-up, but it's not. And it's actually another way that I can grab hold of things and turn them to open them. And I even tried to make some of my own kind of things. This is like a dog treat toy and a pencil grip. So I figured if I glued that on there and I made that like that, then it would be easier for me to hold. So some things I made, but some things also are, some things also can be bought or acquired, made in a better shape, like a spoon like this. So those are all new things I have to try. And I have to also try learning to use my hand in a different way. One of the things that I have done a lot since I was very little is sleep with my hand under my head like this, but actually that's one of the things that's hurting my arm. So I cannot sleep like that. So one of the things that I also have to try is sleeping with this kind of thing on, and I turn it around this way and it makes my elbow not bend all the way. So I've been thinking about that. I've been thinking about all these new things I have to try. And some of them, especially the sleeping in a different way part, is not something I want to do. And some of it is stuff that I have to do, or else my wrist is gonna keep, I'm gonna be making it worse. And I've been thinking about that because I've also been thinking about how this is one part of my body. It's a body part that I have to learn new ways to think about that. And the people in the Bible and the story that Priscilla may tell us about had to learn new ways to feed themselves or eat or get along or worship. And so my assignment to my friends out there, because I know you miss my Sunday school homework, is about what kind of things are you trying that are new? What does that feel like? What kind of advice do you have when people are trying something new? What kind of new things do you want to try, or do you want your communities to try? And think about that, maybe draw a picture about it, talk to your grown-ups about it, and maybe next week or throughout the week, you can get in touch with us and share about that a little. And my new timer to tell me how long I should be talking is almost running out. But I just wanted to say hello and yay for new things, even though they're a little bit scary. God is still with us. Thanks.
Thank you, Ovid. Thank you so much. We are so glad.
Hi.
Ovid, yeah. If anyone has... Hi, Elena. Hi, Josiah. Hi, Adrian. I see you. Really good to see you guys. Ovid, thank you so much. We're so glad that you are finding ways to take care of yourself, that you're finding new ways to make things easier and better and to make them hurt less. And maybe you're doing that and sharing about that will help the rest of us be willing to try new things that will help us, that will make things a little easier for us. It's a pretty hard time for everybody to make certain things less hard or hurt less. It also, your sharing also reminds me of the ways in which it's like our community and world, it's like we're all a body and there are different parts of the body. And so to be thinking about the ways that parts of our body, our community, our church and the world, there are parts of that body that aren't really working very well. And we need to find ways to take care of all of the parts of who we are as a community. So thank you, Ovid. At this time, I invite us to turn our attention to announcements. Thank you, Nick. It's really great to have you as the man behind the curtain this morning. We really appreciate your tech help and appreciate your leadership. There are a whole bunch of announcements, so we're going to sail through some and linger on others. So you may or may not know, in our community, we have a number of opportunities for people to meet in smaller groups for support and connection and learning. So you'll encounter some of these in announcements now. One of them is the Pandemic Parenting Group. If you are a parent or an adult who is guiding children at this time, this very challenging time for kids and for families and for parents and people who parent them and accompany them, Monday evenings at 8:15, there's an opportunity for you to gather with some supportive church folk who've got some good experience to think together about how we support one another through these difficult days. So please join us for that. There's a sci-fi book club that's meeting this Tuesday at 6:30, and they will be discussing The City We Became by N.K. Jemisin. Feel free to join, even if you haven't read the book, and maybe you hope to, or you just love sci-fi and would love to gather. Please join there. Please note also that links for these will be shared. We'll put them out in an All Church email. If you are not on our All Church email list at this time, we invite you to, in the chat box, you can put your email address. You can either put it to Kip's attention or my attention. I'm Linda Noonan. You can send us a chat and we'll make sure you're on the All Church email list so that you get the Zoom links to these meetings. Church Council will be meeting next Sunday after church. Trustees are meeting a week from tomorrow. We have an annual congregational meeting taking place in early October on October 7th in the evening. There's a Friends and Members Facebook group there. If you have prayer requests, we would love, as pastors, we would be honored to be praying with you and for you. And one way you can do that is by sending an email to this email address, prayers@chestnuthillunited.org. And maybe maybe Nick or someone can put that in the chat box as well. prayers@chestnuthillunited.org. Could you do the next slide, please, Nick? Number of other things. Karen Mesner will be offering some workshops through the Naramata Center. We have arranged so that you, if you would like to take any of these workshops, can do that at no cost to yourself. So please note these workshops that are coming up. We will also send these out in an All Church email. We have a community newsletter that gives you the links and more information about all these support groups and also highlights voices and shares some stories. If you are interested or have some feedback or would like to share something in that newsletter, you can send Margaret an email and her email address is there. after church today. We hope you can stick around for a little bit of time to kick off. Oh no, actually Margaret's going to share information about that. But before actually I turn it over to you, Margaret, I want to highlight two other things. One is October is right around the corner, and that means two things. First, it means blessing of the animals, which is one of our other high holy days at this church. We are going to do a pandemic version of that, and Kip and I will be on at church on Sunday, October 4th, to following kind of appropriate protocols, bless animals. If you want to drive by, we will give your pet a distance blessing, we'll bless your pet. And you can do that between 9:45 and 10:45 on Sunday, October 4th. We'll ensure that people kind of stay distanced. You'll just be in kind of cars. We'll have a drive-by blessing that we will Zoom to anyone interested, and then we'll continue worship at 11 o'clock on the 4th. The rest of the Sunday in October will be Justice and Witness Month, formerly known as Outreach Month. That's the time of the year when we raise the bulk of our funds for our justice initiatives. And we've got some really powerful preachers and speakers scheduled for October. So we hope you'll join us for all of October and be ready to kind of tap into your generosity so that we can really lean into these justice initiatives. So stay tuned for more about that. All right, thank you so much. And Margaret, I'll invite you to tell us more about Voter Sunday.
Right. Hello, Chestnut Hill United. My name is Margaret Ernst, and I use she and her. I am our Associate Pastor for Community Engagement. And happy Voter Sunday! Yay, 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 yay. I share that with you with the very serious conviction that voting is sacred, for us to have a voice in our democracy and about how things are run, and also to defend and expand that democracy. So unfortunately, with the pandemic, as you all know, and attempts at voter suppression, voting this year could not be any more confusing. However, that is why we think we need to take it on together, not just our own votes, but to make sure that everybody in our community, our families, like your Uncle Joe, your neighbor down the street, new voters who are people who have just turned voting age, we want to be able to make sure everybody in our community is voting and knows how and gets through all of the snags. So after service today, we invite you to join us for a half hour, possibly less, but no more than a half hour, gathering to hear from Jamie Stroud and from Marissa Tice on our power team, who will share with us power's specific challenge to our congregation to engage a certain number of people in our communities. So we actually have the fortune of being a part of power as an organization where we are not alone, and we have some helpful special tools. And also power will be doing voter engagement phone banks, which will be happening on Tuesdays and Thursday evenings every week between now and the election, from 6 p.m. to 8:30. So you'll learn more how to get involved with those phone banks and to help us meet our goal with power after service. So it's important that you join us if you can, and that we don't give in to despair, but we work hard. If you've been feeling hungry for concrete ways to do something to make sure folks vote this year, this is a great time to join us. So happy Voter Sunday.
Thank you so much, Margaret. I am Priscilla Tennant. My pronouns are she and her. I'm so glad to be with you this morning. Ovid sort of introduced for us that we're going to try something new after service, which is just that we're going to invite you to engage with the text and the message with any reflections or questions you might have. So that'll be just a new brief segment that will be moderated by Margaret right after the sermon. So get your questions and thoughts ready. We're excited. For the first reading today, we will hear from our great ancestor, Nina Simone. It'll be an audio recording of her song that was released in 1967, and it's called "I Wish I Knew How It Would Feel to Be Free." Actually, Nick, I'm going to need to ask you to stop sharing your screen so that I can share the song. Thank you so much.
Not a problem.
Not a problem. Thank you.
I have just discovered a new spiritual practice, which is to listen to Nina Simone while I'm on gallery view watching you all bop along. So thank you for joining me in that spiritual practice. Our second reading comes from the Hebrew scriptures. I'll be reading from Exodus chapter 16, verses 2 to 15. They began to complain against Moses and Aaron there in the wilderness. The people of Israel said to them, "If only we had died by Yahweh's hand in the land of Egypt, when we sat next to pots of meat and ate our bread till we were filled. But now you have brought the whole community out into the wilderness to die of hunger." Then Yahweh said to Moses, "Look, I will rain down bread from heaven for you. The people will go out and gather a day's portion every day so that I can test them to see if they will follow my instructions. On the sixth day, when they prepare what they brought in, it will be twice as much the daily gathering." So Moses and Aaron said to the Israelites, "In the evening, you will know that it was Yahweh who brought you up out of Egypt. And in the morning, you will witness the glory of God, the one to whom you directed your complaints, For who are we that you should complain to us? Moses continued, it is Yahweh who will give you meat in the evenings for your meal and all the bread you want in the morning, because Yahweh has heard your complaints. For it is not us that you are complaining, who are we, but to Yahweh. Then Moses said to Aaron, tell the whole Israelite community, present yourselves before Yahweh, who has heard your complaints. As Aaron was speaking to the whole Israelite community, they looked towards the desert, and there was the glory of Yahweh appearing in the form of a cloud. Then Yahweh spoke to Moses and said, I have heard the complaining of the people of Israel. Say to them, in the evening you will eat meat, and in the morning you will have your fill of bread. Then you will know that I, Yahweh, am your God. So it was about that in the evening. So it came about that in the evening, quail flew in and all around the camp. And in the morning, there was a layer of dew all around the camp. When the layer of dew evaporated, there on the surface of the desert were flakes of something, delicate, powdery, fine as frost. When they saw it, the people of Israel said to each other, what is it? Not knowing what it was, but Moses told them, this is the bread Yahweh has given you to eat. This is the word of God. I have to say that it feels audacious to try to bring a message of hope given the circumstances we find ourselves in. And I'm learning that as people who want to mourn skillfully, that we should invite grief and name our losses. Many of us were facing challenges before the pandemic, health challenges and financial insecurity. And those have been compounded for so many with this invisible virus that is sticking along a lot longer than any of us hoped. And then in the midst of all the losses related to that virus and the shutdowns, we also continue to lose significant public figures who symbolize so much more than the work that they did. We've talked about Chadwick Boseman and the ways that his work symbolized so much more than just acting or movie making. And now we've lost Ruth Bader Ginsburg, and we're all feeling that and thinking about the great work she did and the ways she inspired us to equality. So there's a lot going on, and I think we should continue to name it. But this story in Exodus 16, the story of God's gift of meat and manna to the Israelites, it allows me to show up with bold audacity and fully formed hope. The story begins after God has delivered the Israelites from the bondage of slavery. But what happens when the liberation that you envision doesn't actually free you? So, first, in the metaphor of this Bible story, I propose that we think of the wilderness as simply life. The conditions get better and worse as seasons change, but the trials don't start coming our ways. And the next thing I want to talk about is this idea of complaining. You know, when I ask someone how they're doing, and they say, oh, I can't complain, I get pretty suspicious. Because I think that it means one of two things. It means either that person might be in denial about all that they are dealing with, or it might be that they're thinking that complaining and gratitude are mutually exclusive, and that when they think about this false hierarchy of suffering, that they think they might be on a higher rung than some people, and they're trying to acknowledge that. But if we look at the actual complaint that is in this Bible story. In verse 2, it says, they began to complain against Moses and Aaron there in the wilderness. The people of Israel said to them, if only we had died by Yahweh's hand in the land of Egypt, where we sat next to pots of meat and ate bread till we were filled. But now you have brought the whole community out into the wilderness to die of hunger. When you're starving, you have the right to complain. When you are in a pandemic, you have the right to complain. When you are sick and tired of being sick and tired, and you are living in wilderness conditions, I encourage you to complain, to cultivate circles of care of people who will listen to you and take you seriously, no matter how small or large your grievance might be. I think the text is giving us full permission to complain and know that holy listening, the universe, your people, your God will respond to your complaints. In the text, Aaron and Moses, the leaders, help the community distinguish between the difference between complaining and blaming. And it gets tricky because at the point that we turn to blame and try to figure out who's at fault, who's responsible for all of this mess, it calls us to do two really hard things. The first thing that it calls us to do is think about where is God in all this suffering, which is kind of the paradox of Christianity, right? A question that we're always grappling with. And then the second thing it causes us to do is think about our participation and some of the mistakes we've made and the ways we may have contributed to things. And I think those are two important things to do and things that we are forced to grapple with all the time. Now, when scholars look at this passage, they lift up four interrelated images for God that they think show up in this text. The first is God, Yahweh, as the God of life. So both the creator of life and the sustainer of life is the way, one of the ways that we can think of God showing up in the passage. The next is a God who takes initiative with us because we belong to them. The third way is Yahweh as the mighty God, the all-powerful God that can meet us in our place of need and provide what we need. And then the final one that they lift up is a God who seeks an intimate relationship with us. And I think these images of God are helpful for us to remind ourselves as we face our own wilderness conditions. So the real question for us then is, what does liberation look like and feel like? Nina Simone said it best. I wish I knew how it would feel to be free. Initially, the liberation of the Israelites was about breaking free from Egyptian bondage. But what happens when the liberation that we envision doesn't actually free us? In Exodus, what do the Israelites get for all their trouble? Eventually, Yahweh endows them with an all-encompassing law with a capital L. And how does that equate to liberation? The purpose of the law was to lead them to fullness of life with God. And it might be also a beautiful way for us to think about our own liberation. That's what we're working towards. How do we stop right where we are with all these harsh wilderness conditions? Stop pursuing some future state or destination and try to liberate in place, which involves re-envisioning it, defining it for ourselves, and co-creating it with each other as we look to our mighty God to guide us and to have a fuller life with God. Sonia Renee Taylor, who is the author of The Body Is Not an Apology, says, "My assignment is to survive. My assignment is to thrive in the way my ancestors were not able to do." And she goes on to say, if you are a descendant of enslavers, if you are the descendant of colonizers, if you are the descendant of those who have caused massive harm, your assignment, your ancestral task, is to heal your ancestral line. Finally, we know that in the end, when God provided what the Israelites needed, the Israelites couldn't quite recognize the blessing for what it was. They still couldn't see that they had what they needed. Has this ever happened to you? Somebody's asking you to get something, maybe the salt in the pantry, and you go and you look for it, and you say, "It's not here." And they say, "It's on the third shelf in the right, on the right side. I'm sure it's there." And you say, "It is not here." And then they come over and they immediately find it. Well, I found out that there's actually a term for that. It's a real thing. I thought it was just me and the dynamic between me and my mother. But the actual term for it is skomata. And it is considered like a mental block. And the reason why they can find it is because they believe that it's there. And the reason why we can't find it is because we doubt that it's there. And when our faith falters, if we can remember what God says in verse 12, "In the evening you will eat meat, and in the morning you will have your fill of bread. Then you will know I am your God." May this reassurance help liberate you, help you liberate in place, leading as God as you free yourself and others. This is the good news of God. Amen.
Amen. Some of us were able to join a virtual worship service with a church called The Gathering, a womanist church. And womanist means a Black feminist or a feminist of color. Black American activist and author Alice Walker has used this term to describe Black women who are deeply committed to the wholeness and well-being of all humanity. According to Alice Walker, womanists unite women of color with the feminist movement at the intersection of race, class, and gender oppression. So in that service, something very powerful we experienced was after the preached sermon, they had a moderated conversation called Talk Back to the Text. And womanist preachers seek to approach the homiletic texts in a responsible manner, wanting to know more than what is on the surface and to go into that deep exegetical work, which means taking out of the Bible, to look at the biblical text through a lens of liberation. So we are going to use their model and invite you to talk back to the text. If you have a reflection or response or a question about the text that Priscilla preached on or in her message, this is the time to write it in the chat or raise your virtual digital hand so we can hear from you. We welcome your questions, whether you have been coming to this church for 30 years or whether today is your first time joining us. We are here in the sanctuary this morning together, and that is what matters. So I will start off with a question of my own in order to model this. And while I am asking, feel free to take note of your questions to write them in the chat box. We have about 5 minutes, so we probably have time for about 3 questions, I would imagine. Priscilla, I am very, very struck by your metaphor of, what was it called?
Skomata.
Skomata, okay. not only am I now gonna identify as a skomatist every time I lose something with my partner, which is regular. I am very struck by how you just made that connection for us to what it means to find something and be able to achieve it because you're imagining it. And what I heard in the text was Moses and Aaron telling the Israelites wandering to believe them, like, trust me, believe that this is coming, that this manna is coming, that what God has promised is coming. So, however, if I were a hungry Israelite at that time, I would have said, I will literally believe that when I see it. And I'm feeling similarly these days about some of our leaders' response around the pandemic. They're like, oh, it's just gonna disappear. We just have to believe that. So from your perspective and from this perspective of this text, what do you believe is the difference between visionary thinking and wishful thinking?
Well, my response first would be that it's really hard because at this moment, it's really easy to look to leadership and feel very frustrated. I think for me, one of the approaches that has been helpful is how can I stop where I am and look at what God has given us and what are the adaptations we've been able to make during this difficult time? There's so many. I mean, if you start to look for them and think about them, you can see them in your own life and in the life of people all around you. And so when I think about this pandemic lately, what I'm trying to do is think, I'm not going to wait for the end of it anymore. I'm going to think about if this is my reality and I don't have an end point, how can I look at what's already around me that I have that will help equip me? What is God pointing out to me? And how do I stand still, claim liberation here, lean on God, the people around me, and be grateful for the adaptations that we've already been able to make?
Thank you for that. It sort of reminds me of like looking to a different kind of evidence. Like I'm not a scientist, but I am aware that there's different ways you can take in data, right? So I see that Michelle has her hand raised and Kathy Jacobson has her hand raised, digitally speaking. And so let's go to Michelle. Are you ready to share your question? You can take yourself off mute and just let us know if you need help with that.
Okay, I did it. I wasn't sure if I did it or you did it. What struck me with your sermon, Priscilla, is that, with the reading, was that the Israelites couldn't recognize the blessing, the food blessing initially, like when the dew fell and then the dew went away, and then they were left with that fine powder. I guess I had this picture in my head that there were loaves of bread on the rocks, right? That somehow in the morning, they woke up and there were nice hot cross buns on top of the rocks. That was just, and I probably saw in my childhood or somewhere, or even adulthood, a picture that looked exactly like that. So it struck me with the reading that they had to work. They were provided the foundation or the elements, and then they had to create the bread. Or the sustenance, and also that the quail apparently was alive. That's another thing, right? So I had always imagined this nice platter with a perfectly cooked bird on top of it. And of course, that's not how, you know, the story, you know, if we're to kind of ground it in some sort of reality that would not just be a platter with a bird. So I wonder if you could just comment on that they were provided these as initial foundational elements, but then there was some work that they had to do in order to provide for themselves.
Yeah, Michelle, I think you just preached it, which is like what are the ways that we're given the elements, but they're not fully formed, and that part of it is how do my gifts and my determination and the things that I already have, how does that meet the basic things that I have that aren't fully formed and can only come to fruition and be the blessing because I have brought my gifts to it as well. So I think it's like, we get some basic elements and what are we gonna do with them, right? There's stuff that you're gonna be able to do with the same elements that's gonna look different from what someone else does because we're all endowed with different gifts. And then how do we rely on other people's gifts as well as part of our liberation? Maybe I don't have what it takes to make the bread into what it is because I'm a really bad cook. But maybe my friend Michelle is really good at coming up with recipes and suddenly her gift can meet my point of need and what's already in front of me. So it's really beautiful because I don't think we can do it alone. We have to rely on each other. But I do think that God keeps giving us these basic elements and sometimes we don't see them for what we are because like you said, Michelle, we have to work and fiddle with them for them to actually be an adaptation.
Thanks.
Thanks, Michelle, for your excellent question. I'm recognizing with this that we do have hard questions. So Priscilla is really doing a brave thing here by being willing to answer on the spot. And our final question will be from Kathy Jacobson. So Kathy, you can take yourself off mute or I can take you off if that's easier.
Well, mine is less of a question and more of a comment that's very personal and strikes me because I'm looking at thinking about the power of belief and the power also of borrowing from someone else's belief. And, you know, you talk about looking, you know, you can't find the salt. Your mother says the salt's there and you say, no, it's not, but your mother knows that it's there. And it's changing my mindset as I think about all of the things that I'm saying I can't do. I can't like it here. I can't like this. And it makes me think of something Brené Brown said also, which is try saying yes to things instead of saying no, say yes to what's around you. And so it's the power of belief and the power of harnessing that. And if you change your mindset and listen to those who believe, even if you don't, it can change your mindset and actually make things happen. And I don't think that, I think we can get stuck in not believing. That doesn't help us. So I thank you for bringing that up and it's, I'll hold on to it.
Thank you, Kathy. Yeah, I think we all have to rely on other people's belief because we have moments when we are stronger or for many different reasons, sometimes because of the wilderness conditions. So how can we rely on other people's belief when ours is not at its strongest? Because that's real. So thank you, Kathy.
So that closes our first inaugural edition of Talk Back to the Text. Thank you all so much for your questions. At this church, we really believe that in living the questions, we figure out the answers together, even when it creates more questions. So thank you to you all and to Priscilla for her word.
Now this is the time of the service.
Thank you, Margaret. Thank you, Kip. Thank you for the prayers. Our spotlight on generosity time after our offering will be a little bit of a reprise of our Water Sunday experience last week. Before we go to that, I want to invite you to consider what it means for you to give to this congregation through your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, what it means to be part of something bigger than yourself, what it means to give generously toward that. There are some ways that you can give online and by text or by check. I'll ask Nick to copy those links and text number and put those in the chat box for your prayerful consideration. And as you do that, I invite us to take a little look at what happened over the course, last week. I invited folks to send me pictures and video clips of themselves and their water. And some of us gathered last week to celebrate Water Sunday. And here's a little bit about what that looked like. Nick, I think we're going to need to start that again with computer sound.
All right, I got it this time.
You're so awesome, and we appreciate you so much.
All right.
In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God hovered over the water. Water Sunday is one of the high holy days of Chestnut Hill United Church in Philadelphia. It's a time when we celebrate the gift of water. This year, we celebrated the water that was poured into the bowl physically as well as symbolically. Some came to the front porch of the church when no one was around to pour in their water and snap a picture. Some left their names and drawing on the porch steps. Some sent in pictures from places across the country where they found rest or refreshment.
Our water this year is from Wildwood, New Jersey. We spent a couple days there just to hang out and refresh. And the other water that Wesley has is from one of our trips to the creek. We spent many weekends finding different watering holes to splash around in.
And some of us, in careful pandemic protocol style, gathered in masked and socially distanced ways to celebrate the gift of this community and put our feet on the holy ground of the churchyard, surrounded by the cloud of witnesses buried in this soil, some going back to the Civil War and beyond. We gathered on land traditionally stewarded by the Lenape Hoking. Our church, like everything else around us, is here through stolen land and stolen labor. We collect and pour water in remembrance of this past and as prayer that our lives and work may honor these sacred lands and these sacred lives.
So this is for all the people who are struggling and suffering, and we know beyond the hospitals right now there are so many, and I salute them, and I love them, and my prayers are for them.
The waters we offered this year come from streams and rivers, from creeks and kitchen taps. There's water from hot tubs and bird baths, from oceans and swimming pools, from garden hoses and housing encampments. People gathered water from places they found rest, connection, sanctuary. There was coming home water, on the pilgrimage water, noticing my privilege water, and Mahalia's, I'm giving you a beautiful green fish as a bonus water. It is this water, and maybe even the fish, that we will pour into our beautiful baptismal font to use for this next year.
So this water is just from our kitchen sink. We've been out of town for a year. And it would have been fun to have brought back water from where we had been, but we were not prepared, and it's sort of hard to do that on airplanes.
Yeah.
But this can symbolize our joy coming back to our house and our community, and this water is from a very special place because it's the place that we've come back to.
It's like in a creek, and then that creek comes down through Philly, so it kind of connects like my suburban Ambler to Philadelphia, which I think is really cool. And it's also kept that, like, system of trails has kept me sane throughout the pandemic. So,
amen.
It is a special place.
No element is mentioned more often in scripture than water. Water for cleansing, water for baptism, for refreshment and life. Water for transition from one stage of life to another. Water for blessing. We claim the water of life whose rush announces the birth of a baby, the water of life that nourishes seeds and plants and roots deep in the earth.
Very special creek where my parents live, and we spent lots of time there this summer. Sean and I got married by Pine Creek, and it's a very special place to us.
We are entering into the 175th year of this church. We've only been gathering to pour water in this particular way for Water Sunday for the last 20 years. But this congregation and community has been sprinkling and pouring and baptizing and praying and working and discerning and changing for so much longer than that. Blessed is the one, Psalm 1 says, who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked or stand in the way of sinners or sit in the seat of mockers. But their delight is in the law of the Lord, and on God's law they meditate day and night. They are like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers. May we be like streams planted by the water, yielding fruit in this season for this world. May this water be just a drop in the bigger bucket that is the life and faithfulness of this church. And may it nurture the seeds that are planted within and among us for 175 years to come.
And I guess I'll move on to the part of the remember your baptism.
And yes, Jamie helped us to remember that if we were together in person on Water Sunday and when we celebrate baptisms in the sanctuary, we sprinkle with great abundance and enthusiasm one another. So may we all remember our baptism. We'll do our closing song, and just given the time, I think I'll invite us to do the first two verses. So we'll do the first kind of four paragraphs. So I invite you to sing along if you know this song as we sing together. We are called. I'm coming. Come live in the light, shine with the joy and the love of the Lord. We are called to be light for the kingdom, to live in the freedom of the city of God. We are called to act with justice. We are called to love tenderly. We are called to serve one another, to walk humbly with God. Come, open your heart. Show your mercy to all those in fear. We are called to be hope for the hopeless, so hatred and blindness will be no more. We are called to act with justice. We are called to love tenderly. We are called to serve one another, to walk humbly with God. And clearly Maggie is being called to leave my office, but there we go. So over to you, Kip.
So receive this benediction and then maybe stick around for our Voting Sunday conversation. But go from this place, whatever this place is for you, naming your grief, naming your losses, complaining when you need to complain, but also look around to see what is here for you, the gifts that are here waiting all along, the gifts of your insight, of your ingenuity, the gifts of faith of others that you can lean on when you need to, the gifts of each other that will draw us together, the gifts that will help us to see what it takes to liberate in place. Go in peace. Amen.
So we invite you to stay for however long you want, but we will be spending about 25 minutes to half an hour to discuss voting. So I welcome you to Voting Sunday if you are staying, and if you are not, then sign off now. And there are no hard feelings, but do stay if you feel so called. Hey, Nick, can you please make me a co-host again? For some reason, it says I am no longer a co-host.
And feel free to take yourself off mute if you want to say hello or goodbye or give us a word as we transition into the next space.
Linda, you're the host, so you may need to be the one to
Make me a co-host. Gotcha.
All right, great. Yes, everyone should feel free if you want to chat while I get our little slides set up. You're welcome.
Bye, everyone. Thank you for a great service.
Good to see you.
Amen.
All right, okay, Voting Sunday. So let's kick off the voting season and get our people out to vote. I thank Marissa Tice and Jamie in particular for their help developing this time together today. So I'll pass it off to them, but I will start with a prayer because as I mentioned in the service, I do believe that we all know that voting is sacred work. So let us go to our Creator and our Sustainer as we pray for this time together. Dear God, we know that you want us to live in a world in which each of our life matters and in which we have a government and people who lead, who believe that we are as sacred as we know ourselves to be. Please help us to use our brains and our hearts and our bodies in the ways that we can to make sure that we each vote and that everybody that we love in our communities votes as well. Thank you for the leadership in our church so that we can make this happen. Amen.
Amen.
So I believe I'm passing it to Jamie. You can unmute yourself to share and I'll take my screen off here.
Okay, and unfortunately, I printed out the wrong agenda for myself. So power has challenged all of the congregations that are part of the power organization to do work on voter education and encouragement. And they have requested that each congregation, they would like to have, there's a formula, 100 congregations to have 40 members to call 30 persons each or contact 30 persons each about voting, asking them to check to see if they're registered themselves to vote, because some places people have accidentally been removed from the rolls. So you need to check for yourself to be sure you're registered. You can do this. They're saying we can do it by text, email, however many ways we can find to promote what we want to do to help increase the number of voters getting out there. That I think that about covers what I was supposed to say at this point in time. And I will turn it over to Marissa, who has some great ideas to share with us.
So when I went to this power meeting, it was before the pandemic. And I was very excited. and now we're getting closer, and 30, I think, can feel overwhelming. So for me, I had to kind of like think about the people in my life and how I engage with them. And sometimes I get really excited about these things and I'm messaging people and talking about people, but if I don't think of the way that I'm contacting them and how they're receiving it, sometimes, you know, I'm kind of the, I don't know how to explain it. Like somebody who's coming after them. Did you do this? Did you do that? Did you, you know, and I don't want to be somebody who, is sort of, you know, for lack of a better word, like policing people, you know, to vote. So I've kind of thought about, for me, setting aside certain time each night and say, well, what five people can I text tonight? Because 30 is just like such a big number and I get really easily sidetracked with just managing my kids' needs. So, you know, each night could I set aside 30 minutes or probably less, you know, to contact five people a night this week and just say something more like, I'm looking for sort of people to hold me accountable. So it's a little more, you know, you're helping me, you know, and I want to help hold you accountable also. Are you registered to vote? You know, sending maybe here's the link. For how to check your registration, because even for me being somebody who cares about this, when it came down to knowing my own status, I wasn't sure, you know, it's like, there's so much online, there's so much information. Like I kind of needed simple baby steps on how to like, you know, just look for what my status was. So, that's kind of my idea. And then suggesting, you know, saying, are you registered to vote? And do you have a plan? What's your plan? This is my plan. And when I'm done voting, I'm going to text you to let you know that I voted. So ultimately, my idea is that on election day, or if people have mailed in their ballots, you know, by election day, I have 30 texts that said, you know, I voted. So that's a way that it's sort of holding people accountable and myself accountable. But also, I kind of get a commitment. And it's not just like, well, I contacted these people and hopefully they'll vote. So for my circle, I think people will be receptive to that and it will be helpful and I can manage that. But I'm curious to know for other people hearing that challenge, what are ways that you feel like you could, you know, engage your family and friends and neighbors?
This is Faith. I've been feeling some of the same way that you do, Marissa. I'm an oldest, like in my family growing up, so I have a tendency to be a bit of a scold. So I didn't want to do that, but I want to do something because I feel it's important. So I spend a lot of time creating a website that I'm trying to get search engine optimization on. And I've spent a lot of time making these animated videos because exactly what you said, it's hard to get good information that's easy, all in one place, that's comprehensible. So is it okay if I share my screen to show you what I did? Let's see.
Yeah, please.
Just make okay. You our host to do that, but I can do that.
Okay, yeah. Okay.
Let's see, I'm finding Faith. Okay, I'm gonna make you a co-host and Faith, you should be able to share your screen now for a moment.
Okay, great. Okay, so there's the website there. And let's see, hold on. Can I get back?
You can't see it yet, so you might need to push share screen again.
Oh, okay. Oh, hold on. I see what you're saying. Can
Yep, we can see it now.
Okay, good. Mail, how to register. What happens to my mail-in ballot after I send it in? And so far the statistics on YouTube tell me that that's my most popular video. And then how to deliver your mail-in ballot without the post office. And so watch those, they're a little cartoon, so people like those. And then go down here, and as you said, it's hard to get good information, so I just made it into buttons. And then these go right to, like, if you want to do to the application, you don't have to go through a bunch of different screens. And then I went down here for registration, information about voting by mail and voting in person, and then just a little thing about how it's going to take a couple weeks to really know what the results are. So just be patient. So that's my site.
I'm going to put Faith, this website, this glorious website you've created, in the chat so that folks know what it is. PA-vote-by-mail.org.
Yes.
Wow. Wow, wow, wow. Marissa, go ahead.
Is it
no, I love that.
Thank you.
Yep, Faith.
Yeah.
Is this something we can all share?
Oh, absolutely. I want people to share it on social media and get out the word.
Super. That's fantastic.
Yeah, Faith, thank you. This is Beth. This answers prayers. Oh. I'm downtown in Philly, and I bump into 100 people a day. And I have had different websites. I carry my signs around. I have different websites to non-verbally help people, and this is just great. And I live in a condo with like 500 people who need this website because we're all motivated to vote, but getting conflicting information. So thank you.
Yeah. Oh, thanks so much. That's exactly why I wanted to make it, because it's all in one spot. It makes it easy to go to, and then the animations make it fun. Oh, thanks
it's
a lot.
It's fabulous. It's really good. I mean, I think that it's, you know, I think there are a lot of people that might know one part of it, but they don't know all the parts of it. So to have it all in one place like that is really great. So for example, I know people that have already registered to get mail-in ballots, but they're afraid to mail in their ballots, right? So the fact that now, you know, I can help them say, okay, well, if you don't want to mail in your ballot, then here's, you know, where you can find out where drop boxes are or whatever. It's fabulous. Thank you.
Oh, thank you. Thanks. I appreciate that a lot. It means a lot to me. I've been up, oh my gosh, I haven't been getting sleep for the last week because the animations take hours and hours just for a 3-minute video.
I'm sure we could share this with our friends at Power too, because it's so Pennsylvania specific. It seems to, Faith, your videos cover anything in Pennsylvania that's relevant. Is that right?
That's right. All of Pennsylvania. Yeah. Right.
Yeah. And we have Power congregations in Lancaster and Allentown and Reading. So we'll definitely spread it out. This is really exciting.
Okay, good. Thanks. Yeah, Ken's a judge of elections, but also just to make sure all the information was right, I contacted the head of the voting office in Montgomery County, and she looked at all the videos to make sure everything I was saying was right, because there's so much out there, it's confusing.
Yeah, I'm so excited to have that because just like I said, like, you know, you want to ask people and encourage people to vote. And then, but you also feel like as a person who's going to encourage people, you also have to have all the answers. So, you know, that's all as somewhere to say, okay, well, here are the answers if you want to look them, you know, if you just want to click this link. But also for myself, when people, you know, if I'm trying to encourage people and they're asking me questions, then I'm like, okay, I have the resource to find the answers to help people.
Yeah, so. Thanks. And I'm sure you know that things changed just this past week. So now postmarks used to not count and now they do.
Okay.
So I had to, I just, I didn't hire her, but I have a friend who's a voiceover artist. So she did all the voiceovers for free. And I didn't want to ask her to do the voiceover again. So I just cut out that section that said postmarks don't count. And people can just assume now that postmarks do count.
Wow. Wow, I was not expecting to get on this from this meeting. I'm impressed and I'm surprised and I'm so thankful that, you know, that you came to share this with us.
Great.
That's
awesome. Thanks. Oh, that makes me feel so good because it's lonely working till 4 a.m. and not knowing that anybody's gonna see them or not see them. So thank you.
Thank you, Faith. I also wanted to point out, if you didn't see it in the chat, that Katie Erno shared another resource, which is that on voteer.com, doctors or healthcare providers can use a scan code so that if patients want to use it to link directly to register to vote, that's a way that they can spread the message.
That's awesome.
Ovid has his hand up, but I'm after Ovid. Their hand up. Sorry, Ovid.
Hi, Ovid.
I will assume that means I'm being called on. Thank you. I guess one of the things is, and I don't know if this is what this conversation is about or not, but it can be, is that there's a lot of go vote, get out and vote, make sure you vote. Vote, 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 which is important, but also there's a lot, like, it's hard to understand, like, it's not just like, here's a person, here's a person, pick one, you know, there's the questions on the ballots, and there's a lot of positions that people don't necessarily understand, or like know about, or know what, you know, what that role even means. And because a lot of the questions sometimes are not in, I forget what it's called, but it's not in plain English. You know, somebody's like, okay, I showed up to vote and now I'm just gonna push all these buttons or whatever, make all these selections or fill in these bubbles. So if we just say vote, then it's encouraging people to show up and make a choice, but not necessarily making informed choices. So one of the things I usually do is I usually use the Committee of 70 website or resources. And then a couple of friends usually, and they're not always necessarily in the same, the politicians are not necessarily in the same district, area, situation, ward, whatever that I'm in, but people that I know and trust who have politics that align more with mine, or like I know care about certain issues, often put out resources of here's what this candidate is about, or I specifically ask these people about this or whatever. I actually think that, it's kind of hard to, I feel like all those things take a lot of education. And I feel like it often doesn't happen until right before the voting time. So I guess I wanted to bring that up. I feel like part of the responsibility in encouraging people to vote is if we're not explaining all of the all that extensive information to folks, then maybe pointing them in directions where they can understand what, like, resources that are maybe helpful in breaking down some of that. Because I feel like if it wasn't for some of the stuff that I learned in like eighth grade social studies or chose myself to look up, or having friends who have held positions, I wouldn't know what any of that means, particularly the questions, because sometimes the questions are in the way they're worded, sometimes I'm not, sometimes not even just that they're hard to understand, but like you might think you're saying yes to something that you're actually saying no to, or you're rooting for something, but the way the question is worded would make it easy for you to, you know, say, to like vote for something you're not believing in. And I took a look at what the question, the ballot questions were for my area. And they're a lot all about police stuff, which I didn't realize that I hadn't heard. I mean, I'm really not paying attention to anything going on in the world, but I haven't heard anyone say, go vote because part of it will include on this Philadelphia ballot, stop and frisk or funding police or whatever. So I think some of that would encourage people. I'm going to vote because that is what that I saw what the questions are, you know? So I just wanted to put that, add that to the conversation.
I totally agree. While I'm standing in line, I usually like will text a good friend of mine who has similar politics and be like, okay, so I know I'm voting more at the top. Let me know, you know, what buttons am I hitting? I totally agree. And with the 70 committee of 70.org, I think has a lot of really great ways to find that all out. And you expressing that makes me think, you know, as we engage voters, we should know ourselves, like take the responsibility of ourselves to decide how we're planning to vote and do the research now so that when we do share, that's so important to share also, you know, who we are voting for and why. I think that's a great point. Also with the mail-in ballots, when I voted in the primary, being able to have the ballot in front of me and having the time to look at it and like, you know, I didn't have to make a choice right away and submit it. You know, I could take time to really kind of do that research. So, you know, that's a point to make for the mail-in ballots. But yeah, everything you said is, you know, right on, totally.
Marissa, I noticed that Otis has a question.
Yes, hi. Yeah, hi, good morning. I just wanted to piggyback off what Ovid said in that information about the issues that we're voting for. Actually, the last election, I literally spent about 15 minutes in the voting booth. I pulled out my phone. I Googled up each judge I was voting for because the issues are critical. The concerning thing about the current administration is not just the fact that possibly in another 4 years, but another issue that we need to focus on is the judges which we are voting for. The passing of Ruth Bader Ginsburg is actually concerning, but also judges at the district level. The legacy of the current administration when it comes to judges at the district level is very concerning because when certain judges are put in place, for example, stop and frisk issues or issues that may be under the blanket of quote unquote law and order, if those judges disproportionately sentence minorities to the longest possible term, or the longest possible sentence there, it impacts minorities generationally. And if we have quote unquote these judges being voted in, that will push us back at least a good 100 years because not only is the judge actually going to be in there for life, but highly likely he's going to mentor another judge to come in his or her stead. And having that mindset being passed on to next generation of judges, it's going to push us back as minority groups for another 100 years at least. All right. So again, is there a one-stop shop that we could like go to, or one specific website that we could actually go to, that we could get a list of all these issues that we're going to vote on in November, issues/judges, et cetera? Is there a one-stop location that we could go and get that information from? If yes, then if you could put it in the chat, that would actually be useful. And one more point, and that is, again, my accent, I'm from Jamaica. When I look at what's going on in the country when it comes to quote unquote infringement on voting rights, I mean, the world looks up to America as the vanguard of democracy. okay? That country which actually invades other countries to institute democracy in those places. And given that what's going on right now, well, the disproportionately minorities and other persons have been cut off voting lists, and the encroachment of other countries into our democracy, in my view, I believe every single American should be up in arms about what's going on. But the fact that some are nonchalant about it or simply don't care, it's very concerning. Because if this is our path forward, in another 2 or 3 generations, this country will pretty much fall apart. And we have to be aware of these small encroachments and the long-term impact on us sustaining the country that we expect and sustaining our democracy. Those are my points. Thank you.
Hi. So yeah, I'm a committee person. That's their job. There is a committee person in every neighborhood, or we hope there is. So you should be able to contact your party representative for your neighborhood. And one of the great things about being a committee person is that those judges come around to all the party meetings and talk to you, and you are really informed about who the judges are. And so that's a good resource that most people don't realize. When you go to the polls in person, you might be voting by mail this time, but in the past, they're those annoying people that stand out in front of the polls and try to hand you things as you go in, and everybody just passes by real quick, not realizing that those people have studied for months to know all the issues that are on the ballot so they can talk to people who then just want to get by them as quickly as possible. So it's a thankless job. That person will be thrilled that you want to talk to them about judges.
And Faith, how do you find your committee person? This is such an excellent question from Otis, thank you.
If you go to the party's county website and contact the party chair in your county, they'll let you know.
Like the Democratic Party, is that what you mean by party? Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, interesting.
Thank you very much, thank you.
You're welcome.
So go
ahead, Kim.
I just add, I'm going to put this in, let me make sure I'm getting the email correct. It's a .com. So the Pennsylvania Bar Association also does, I don't know how in-depth this is, but every time there's a vote on judges, they will publicize which judges they recommend and which they find to be not so qualified or shouldn't be retained. And they put all of that up in a site called pavotesmart.com. So that's someplace that you can find out about the judges that are up for election.
Marissa, did you want to transition to showing us how to check our registration and how to help others do that? Awesome.
Yeah, sure. I'll show you guys how I checked my registration. Okay. Is it showing okay there?
No, you just need to share your screen at the bottom.
Okay, sorry, let's see. Okay. Okay, is that coming up? Votespa.com?
Yeah.
Can you see it yet? Yes. Okay. So this is what I went to, votespa.com. And then I clicked on voting in PA. I know that it's different on the phone.
The share screen just turned off.
Oh, it did?
Yeah, mm-hmm. It was up and now it's off again.
Okay, hold on. Okay. Did it go away now or is it still here?
No, it's there now.
Okay, it's my first time. Okay, so let me know if it goes away. So I clicked voting in PA and I can scroll down to, what did I do? Voting in PA. And then I clicked check your registration status. And then find your voter registration status by name. And then my county is Philadelphia.
While Marissa does that, Kip, I just noticed the pavotesmart.com doesn't work. So I think, is it maybe that .org?
Hang on, let me get
that figured out so we don't derail this. All right, looks like we see Marissa's.
Yeah, so it's pretty easy. It just came up right away. So, you know, obviously you want to make sure that you're registered how you want to be registered. And then it even comes up with like directions to your polling place and location. So after you do that, on the same website, if I go back, you can also hit register to vote if you're not registered. And that's the same place that you would go to if you need to change your address. So you would fill that out again and change your address and resubmit it.
Marissa?
Mm-hmm?
Where do you see the address as listed on the voter registration? I had trouble with that because on the mail-in ballot application instructions, it says it has to be the exact address that on your voter registration card. And I went online for my mother-in-law and we could not find her address because she moved. So we just guessed and we still haven't heard back. It was August 20th, I hand dropped it off. We still have not heard back that her mail and ballot application has been received. So that's been a stumbling block for me is where it says on the mail and ballot application, your address has to match your voter registration card. Where do you find what it says on your registration card?
Good question. Let me look for that. Right. So when the card came up, I didn't check. It doesn't have the right.
And they're picky. I've heard in the past, they're picky, like if you're in an apartment, like which line it's on when you fill up. It's concerning.
Okay. Yes. Questions I don't have answers to yet, but we can look for that. Definitely. Should I keep sharing my screen or I'm going to stop for now?
All I want to know is if I can call you Marissa Lori from now on, or that was privileged information.
I'm sure. Yeah, then, you know, that's what I, you know, want to be a little more private on Facebook.
Well, I have a question. How many here have checked their voter registration and know whether they are or are not voted, are registered? Okay. That's pretty great.
I have, but maybe there's someone who can be a accompanier to me in this process because I'm a little nervous because I, for the primary, I registered to vote by mail, or either I requested a mail-in ballot, but then my mail-in ballot did not come, even though I requested it at the same time as my partner who lives in the same house and a housemate, theirs came and mine never did. So I couldn't vote in the primary. Well, I guess I could have, I mean, I didn't end up going on election day, sorry. So I'm a little bit nervous about that, about just like, okay, what happens if my ballot doesn't come? And also then if it doesn't come, should I go to the polls on election day in order to
vote in person, or is that considered a fraud because I've requested a mail-in ballot? You know, that's a question I have.
I think they said somewhere that if you had not voted by mail, they would have record of that in the books and would not let you vote a second time. I'm not sure about where I read that, though.
So the issue in the primary was that they had a vendor that the state was not happy with. And, well, first of all, they were overwhelmed because they didn't anticipate the pandemic, obviously. But secondly, the vendor made a lot of similar mistakes to what you're describing, Margaret. So the state switched vendors for this election, and they're hoping that the ballots all go out in bulk instead of piecemeal like what you're describing. The ballots were supposed to go out to anyone who had applied last week, but there was a challenge about the Green Party candidate that kept the ballots from going out right away. So now they anticipate the Green Party candidate's off because he didn't get the right number of signatures. And so now they anticipate the ballots will be arriving around the end of September in the mail. If you don't get it, then you can go to your local polling place and they'll see in the book that you're registered by mail and give you a provisional ballot. Okay, so I can.
In my case, I'm registered.
Go ahead, Otis.
Thank you. In my case, I'm registered, but somehow they only have the first initial of my name there. So how do I go about modifying that? Because I don't think I have to re-register.
Yeah, I feel like it might be worth re-registering just to make sure everything is right. I don't know, does anybody else have any comments on that?
I see that there is on votespa.com, there's also a how to update your registration. I wonder if that's it. I can put the link to that, Otis.
That would be what Beth would need for her mother too, to update the registration, to get the new address in there.
What I'm seeing here is you must update your voter registration if you move or change your address, change your name, or wish to change your party. I don't know if that would be, I mean, you know, you'd be changing the name that's on the registration. So that, to me, seems like the most viable route towards that.
Thank you. That will work. Thank you so much.
Mm-hmm. It looks like it's a different form from a regular. Well, I don't know. Anyway, I think it might actually just be the regular, like re-registering, you know, might be the regular. But that there's, if you go to the chat, there's info there. We are coming at the end of our time, so I want to make sure that, Jamie, you have a chance to share next steps.
Okay, the next steps that we've talked about, we need to create a plan for what our congregation would like to do. So what I'm asking, and I will have to email those that have already left us. So if I don't have your email, like Otis, if you would send me, put on your email in the chat so I would have it and send you an updated letter. But we're looking to have, by September the 30th, have everybody that can send a list of their ideas of what they would like or want to do to help spread the news about encouraging voters to vote. And once you send those to me, I'll compile a master list of suggestions that we will then discuss in more thoroughness at our next meeting. And our next meeting will be Sunday, October the 4th, after church, like this one is. Any questions?
Can you put your email address in the chat box, Jamie, so we can know? And I'll include this in the email that goes out to the congregation.
Sure. Come on, chat, come up here.
If anyone is taking notes while Jamie's doing that, I'll just say that I would love to save myself from typing. So I would just say I would love for there to be like discussion of what some of the ballot questions are and why they're important, or what, you know, yeah, kind of what to explain a little more about what Otis was sharing about. And I know that, you know, we're all in different areas, but even knowing that in Philadelphia, where the church is, what the issues are on the ballot in this, whatever it's called, district, ward, enclosure. I would love for our church to, and beyond, to have discussions about, educational discussions about some of that stuff. And thank you all.
I've added that to the notes. We've made sure to do that. Maybe we can do that in our next time. And also we can try to share. We're going to try to share out information during worship as well, just emphasizing the deadlines and everything like that. Jamie, do you have anything more? Because I was just going to close with showing a slide of the deadlines and information about the phone banks that Power is doing.
Okay, I'm done, I think.
Okay, great. I'm just going to share my screen and I will. Do you all see the Voting Sunday slides?
Mm-hmm. Yes, I do.
Okay, excellent. So, because we're in a pandemic and things are complicated, I just wanted to reemphasize what the deadlines are. Election day is Tuesday, November 3rd. The deadline to register online to vote or to update your registration is Monday, October 19th. That is the same for the deadline. Basically, that's just the overall voter registration deadline, whether you're registering by mail or in person. But make sure if you're registering by mail that you're postmarking your registration by October 19th. The deadline to request a mail-in ballot, which is different from registering, must be received by your county's office by Tuesday, October 27th. So received by, not postmarked by. And I know that we are working on getting the addresses of where you need to send your ballot, your mail-in ballot for like Philadelphia and Delaware County and Bucks County and places that we have a lot of folks. So we'll put those in the notes too. Early voting has already started Monday, September 14th to Tuesday, October 27th, 2020. So make sure you check the dates and hours. And that is a good strategy. I think I am actually might do early voting, might as well. And I also want to emphasize that we have with our partners at Power, you're invited to join a voter phone bank. So if you're really just wanting to do something and you have time in the evenings from 6 to 8:30 on Zoom, this particular link here, I will share in the chat box as well. That's how you can register for these Zoom phone banks to call people across the state. I don't know exactly who they are calling or what, but it'll probably be important and great and fun. So we encourage you to do that. Anything else from our illustrious leaders?
I just want to say thanks to everybody for being here and joining us. And I hope that everybody will be able to put October the 4th on their calendar and join us again then as we look at a fleshed out list and the other discussions that we are considering and that you have suggested.
Any final words for us, Marissa? Marissa Lori?
That's all for me. Thanks, guys.
And just for the sake of the notes, Faith, I was wondering whether, can you say again, who are the people that we can get the names of the judges from?
Yeah, so it's a committee person. So for the Democrats or the Republicans, whatever party you are, the committee person is the person that goes to the party meetings, and the judges have to make the rounds and talk to all those people for, like I said, months on end before the election, so that the committee people know, they have a sense of who the judges are and what their policies are, and they're really good resources for judges.
Great, thank you.
Like Kip said, the Bar Association does do vetting as well. I've been a little, sometimes I don't agree with them. Like when I meet the people in person and talk to them about their record and see their resume, sometimes I feel like there might've been something behind the scenes going on with the Bar Association that I didn't agree with. So that's why the committee people are good sounding boards.
Great. All right, thanks everybody. Thanks for your leadership. Thanks for everything you're doing to get people out to vote. Another resource I'll put in the email to the church is that, separate from Pennsylvania, we all know that voter suppression is really real. So like we can do the best we can to get people to vote, but also there are people who are actively doing the opposite of this, trying to get people to not vote, especially Black and Brown people. And so I learned yesterday about a way that you can donate to pay, I think it's like kind of pay the fees that will help people who have a felony in Florida to vote. We know that Florida in particular is a really essential state right now. A swing state, very important. So I'll include that if like a financial donation is something you're interested in. This is not donation to a specific party. It's to just help expand the voting base in Florida, because now people who have a felony conviction can vote. They have to pay a fee to do so. So you're basically helping directly pay their fees. Awesome. Blessings, everybody. May this work bear fruit. Take care.
Thanks, Jamie and Marissa and Margaret.
Thank you.
Everybody.
All right. Bye-bye, everyone.
Thanks, everybody.
Bye-bye.